Hi, OzInverter. This one's particular one is for Dimitri. He asked for one, so I've done one. But I thought while I'm at it, I might as well show some of the people online. And thank you to Edward here for doing this. I know one or two people want to see what's going on, so here we go. Okay, I'll start it up in a minute, but I'll just point out some of the basic concepts of it. That's the toroid. 22 kilos core, and it's a silicon iron 0.3 thick bound, basically flat strip that's bound all together to make up the size we want, which is basically it's 100 center hole. We've got 120 high and it's 200 on the outside diameter. Now the concept is that the control board with a little tiny chip there, the 8010, little pulse width modulation, pretty well low frequency. It's not, it's kilohertz, it's about 24 kilohertz, so it's not particularly very fast. And that is the unit that is controlled. We have the two drivers below. The two drivers are connected to the power board with the cable. The power board has 24 FETs on it, transistors, high power transistors. These particular ones are a cheaper option. A lot of people go for a different type, but are quite happy with that. It seems to work quite well over the past. And then we have a cooling board behind us, cooling board. Up on the top here are EMI filters for the AC coming out. What we've got here is the actual RCD of the AC coming out, the coil sensings for the meter. We also have on the AC coming from the toroid here, we have AC current sense, so we know how much current's going through it, and we also have the AC feeding into the power board to keep it under control. We can control the actual AC output. There are some mods to do with some of the resistors. That's the AC output trimmer. The better quality the trimmer, the more stable it seems to be. Using a cheap trimmer doesn't always work that well. This is the sub-control board here, and this is what we start up with. I'll show you that in a moment. That's the reset if the board hangs. Now, on this particular type, we're actually using the overtemp to start and stop. Okay, that's that wire there, rather than the pin 6, which can be problematic. Or was that the pin 5? I can't remember now. Anyway, the point, it doesn't really matter. The point is the switch. This is a shielded cable and it's a latching, momentary latching. It should be wired up with the voltage always present until you switch it on and then you shut the voltage off and then the overtemp goes, okay, I'll start. So what we're going to do now is we've got some four 12 volt batteries down there. These are AGMs, they're old ones, one of them's not very good. Three are okay, so we should have a bit of voltage to fire this up and test it. The cables are important. Decent size cables. That is a 250 amp breaker. Even if we just switched it on now, the capacitors inside would charge up and go fut. It doesn't do it very well. So, here is a little starter switch. This is the cables to the either side of the breaker. What it does, it has a 40 ohm resistor on here. So when I switch that down, you'll see the green light suddenly start to come on. Okay, the red's flashing means it's in an overtemp mode, so it should start when I want to. But at the minute, we're just charging the capacitors, and that's what that's doing at the moment. So now I'm going to throw the big switch down there. That's it. So the power is now on to the machine. I will now start her up. You can see the meter's lit up on the DC meter at 51.63. It's not brilliant. As I said, the batteries aren't particularly good. The temps are on. So we got the power going from to the PSU up there, which is feeding the OZ control board and the meters accordingly. I've had to put a little bit of a 12 volt to 1.5 PSU here to supply the meters, so we know what they're doing. The cooling thing itself, board, has two sensors on the toroid, one there and one there. It also has two sensors actually on the PCB board, on the heat sinks. We can pick them up. These ones has one for that and also another one for that. On top of that, the four fans, they run with that one, and that one is the toroid fan, and that one and the other one is the PCB fan, so it blows up and sucks out. So we got good cooling going on here. Okay, here we go. We're going to fire up. There she goes. Okay, so we're on. We got 2387. It seems to hover about. I'd like it to be about 240, but that won't hurt. It seems to be stable now at 238. When you first fire these up, they do tend to fluctuate a bit. The humming is actually the choke. You can just see a bit of humming. This is the DC choke. So we're taking out some of the excess frequency, and we're also getting rid of unwanted heat by using a choke. So we get the idle wattage of this machine down to about 35 watts. So she's just drawing down there. You can see the amp meter's not even moving on tick over. Perhaps it's pulling about, the amp meter's pulling about, what, quarter of an amp? So it's not much at all just on tick over. Should be about 35 watts. Okay, so what we can do now is put on the main light down here. Oh, by the way, I'm just going to switch this off. We don't need that resistor powering up anymore because we've switched over to the main breaker. So I've just turned that off, get that going. Sometimes when you start up, the board doesn't like it and it hangs. And you press the reset button, just a quick pop. It doesn't do anything. All it does is reset the board and then the board starts normally again. Sometimes it hangs, sometimes it doesn't. Okay, that's the... We put on the electricity now feeding to a 100 watt light bulb. I use an old fashioned light bulb because 100 watt, I know what's going in. You can see the amp meter's just crawled up now to 1 amp and a bit. You may be saying, why are you using an old analog amp meter? Because I find that is more precise than all this digital stuff. The digital stuff, yeah, it's telling you, look, it's using 100 watts, but it wanders around. 102 watts, look, there you see. And the battery voltage are now dropping like a stone, because we're pulling power on a crap battery at the end. So my apologies for that. As you can see, the temperature on these is not really a problem. Okay, so I'll leave it ticking over a bit and you can see it sort of working, doing its stuff. The humming is the actual core. The first thing about these cores is keep the damn things tight when you wind them. Wrap them round and round. And this one is a 65, 70 is better, but 65 won't hurt. And you're just trying to get the idle power down at night time. You don't want to be burning 200 watts, which you have with an ordinary transformer, a laminated transformer, square version. But with a toroid, we can get this quite efficient. This is a very efficient machine. Now, the fan cooling won't happen until things start to get warm. Nothing will happen. It's all automatic. You've got the trimmers on the fan cooling. You can just alter them and set them to how sensitive or how fast or how hot it gets. Mm. The other thing to mention is these cables. These are all 50 amp once inside. There's 70 amp coming in, and then from then on I split it off. I use very flexible cables when I'm inside to go to the boards. You don't want to twist and break the boards. That would damage it. Mm. Now, the machine itself, safety. This machine is a real machine, it's no toy. So you can draw 6 kilowatt off it, as long as you like, you get the cooling going. It'll go up to, according to John Tullock in Flinders Island, Australia, the originator of the concept, it'll go up to about 50 kilowatt on surges. But it will run at 15 kilowatt for a few minutes without any hassle. This little trimmer here is the overcurrent. So if you do pull too much power through the actual machine, it'll shut it down. When it shuts it down, the green light comes on. It's quite handy, which is quite nice. I have had it come on once or twice when I've shorted out and tested everything, but it seems to work quite well. Okay, the other thing about this machine is it's our mantra, philosophy of mantra. We keep it simple, we keep it robust, we keep it cost effective. Why? Because like Azutels at the time, I bought a commercial machine, it didn't work, it was a toy. And we both decided to mess around with the Chinese boards. We did this toroid, we wind our own. John's done all the calculations through practical use, not by theoretical, by actually testing it and finding out what the cores can do. And we keep the cost down. This machine with the parts, brand new, is well below $600. If you scrimp and save and get old cores and stack them, which I have done, not on this particular one I haven't, but I do, you can get it down to just sort of $300 with bits and pieces. Nothing is too expensive in here. The filters are important. We're trying to get rid of that filtering. That's coming out of the 24 kilohertz. We don't want that getting out onto the main, so hence those filters. Now, a lot of people tend to build this, and it's difficult for me to say this, but they have to take things apart and test them. And I'm not that way inclined. Unlike John in Flint Design in Australia, we tend to sort of, how can I put it? We test each component, we put it together, we make sure the flipping thing is actually in the right position, we test the resistance, we make sure it's actually doing. We never fire anything up till the whole thing is put together, and the whole lot is together, we fire it up. I don't ever have any troubles, nor does he, but some people do. But you have to build it properly. Okay, as I said, this one's for Dimitri. There you go, Dimitri, for you. Odile, Tatiana, Oksana, for your off-grid log cabin. Good luck for you, lads, anyway. Okay, benefits for this. The benefit of this particular machine is it's very simple. These balls are deliberately designed for through-hole components. The only bit that's an SMD chip is that, and we do a subboard, where you solder that onto the subboard, and then you plug it in. No complications. Mm. The noise you can hear is the choke. I'm going to switch that light off, because as the voltage drops, the choke seems to make a bit more noise. So it's dropped to 49.94. It's picking up now because I've turned off the load. The load is just 100 watt. As you can see, we've dropped off the load. The amperage just starts, and the voltage starts to climb up a little bit. You can see that's drawing 40 watts. It was with a little bit. It's not very accurate. That's why I'm using the amp meter. It's actually about 35 watts, but that's not very sensitive. Probably is if you lower it, but considering this machine can pull 500 amps, you really don't want to have an amp meter that goes over the top. I've got a little amp meter on there. That one's only 100 amp, but since it's only on a test system, this is my test rig, that seems to work quite well. Okay, as I said to you before, the basic heart of the machine is toroid. We wind our own. We can get any material. In the book that I've done, we show you can get any kind of toroids, rob them from something, build your own, do the calculations. We'll show you how to test it and what to get. And then you can make your own. We were looking for about 22 kilos of toroid core. Then we wind it. We resin, follow the process, you get a damn transformer. That doesn't make any noise. That is beautifully quiet. It's the ferrite choke that's making a slight buzzing. The tighter you can get that, the better. You can hear if I touch it. All it is the windings within the multi-fleximin actually rattling a little bit. It's annoying, but there we go. You can get them quieter by using different ones. Okay, originated because John and I wanted a decent inverter, and this is what we've got in the end. So we try to share it to everyone else where we can. Startup, you show me, I've shown you the way to start the thing up. Okay, what's the benefit for renewable energy? Well, the fact you can do it yourself. You don't need to buy a very expensive $3,000 machine to get your electricity when you can make this. And it's, to be honest with you, it's not a toy. It's the real McCoy. Anyway, that's about it. Thank you, Edward, for giving us a quick visit to this. And just be careful when you're building it. Try and keep the cables away. There's a lot of frequencies going on in there. It's a hell of a lot of noise going on. We try to shield it and shut things down. The only cable that really wants shielding is a start cable, that one that goes to the start button. Don't forget, it's only 5 volts. It's low voltage to start and stop. And when I put that button out, okay, the 5 volts is given to the board. It thinks it's in overtemp and starts to flash to tell you it's in overtemp mode. Again, that's in the book. All these explanations, all this stuff is in the book. The boards, well, these are our own boards. We've progressed to these. I will put these with the book, option to buy the boards. So you get the power board, you get the control board, and you get the cooling board, okay? So you get all the boards to do it. It's given you all the information in the book. So nothing is missing in a sense. Wire, I prefer to use new wire. This is enameled wire, 1.8 diameter. 1.8 is probably the best. You need some that, which is the Mylar wrapping tape, and you'll need about 150 meters normally. You can see below some of the little drawings and stuff of how I lay out the actual wires into pairs and run it round when I'm winding the core. And there, of course, is a 22 kilogram another core, which I'll get round to doing another one. Okay, so there we are. I hope that helps those that are thinking about doing one of these. Okay.